And put this other manjushri, the peace instruction and bodhicitta practice, as well as the key to happiness from our distinguished Rinpoche.
您正在收看索达吉堪布仁波切的第五次海外开示。我们有幸在前几次开示中得受莲师和文殊菩萨的灌顶。尊贵的仁波切还给我们传授了修习菩提心以及如何获得快乐的窍诀。
The topic today is interdependence of living beings.
今天演讲的主题是我们的动物朋友，生命的依存之道。
We can surely observe that we live in a world where we cannot survive alone. We cannot eat, wear clothes, or breathe alone.
很明显，我们无法独自存活在这个世界上，即便吃饭、穿衣或者呼吸，都无法不依赖于他人。
The more keenly we are aware of this, the more we will be ready to take responsibility for the welfare of other beings. However, most of us are too busy fulfilling our own goals while ignoring the needs of other beings. Taking animals as an example, we may take their lives for food and their skins for clothes.
越能认清这一点，我们就能更好地担负起利他的责任。然而，我们大多数人都忙于实现自己的目标，无视他人的需求。以杀生为例，我们用动物的生命来满足口腹之欲，用它们的皮毛来做衣服。
I remember once Rinpoche was asked what surprised him most about humanity, and he answered, "Man, because he sacrifices his health in order to make money, then he sacrifices his money to recuperate his health." And then he's so anxious about the future that he does not enjoy the present. The result being that he does not live in the present or the future. He lives as if he's never going to die, and then dies having never really lived.
我记得有一位仁波切被人问及人类让他最汗颜的地方，他说，人总是牺牲健康来获取钱财。用赚得的钱换回健康，总是处在对未来的焦虑中，而无法享受当下，结果他的未来也落空了。他活着的时候好像自己永远不会死，而当他死的时候又好像从未好好活过。
This is quite typical of us modern human people. We live our life with a lack of concern for other beings and a lack of awareness of interdependence, only to find that we're harming others and eventually ourselves. On the ultimate plane, there's no reason to suffer. But on the relative level, we may have to go through pains from time to time. The root cause of our suffering is our mistaken feeling of separateness.The view that we're totally independent of each other.
现代人的确如此，我们生活在对他人关爱的缺失中，生活在对缘起观念的无明中。究竟而言，我们没有什么可痛苦的，但是显现上，我们不得不时常经历一些痛苦，而我们痛苦的根源，便来自于与这个世界分离的错觉。我们不懂得彼此相互依存的道理。
So tonight, Rinpoche will share his thought on how to treat others with love and compassion, with respect and love, especially our animal friends, and how this attitude will bring far-reaching benefits to all living beings.
今晚，上师仁波切将告诉我们如何用尊重与爱意去对待其他的生命。特别是我们的动物朋友，而这也将对一切生命产生深远的利益。
If you want to learn more about Khenpo Rinpoche's teachings, you can go to his official website www.khenposodargye.org, where many of his teachings with English translations are available. Today's teaching will also be shared on the website. We'll be very happy if you can send us any feedback or comments on our on today's teaching, especially about our translation.
如果你想要进一步了解仁波切，可以登录他的英文官网。 许多仁波切的教言已翻成英文，今天的开示稍后将在英文官网上发布。对于今天的开示，你有任何建议与意见，我们都很乐意接受，特别是对于今天的翻译。
Now, Rinpoche's lecture begins.
现在仁波切马上就要开始他的开示了。
藏语是吧？汉语哦。今天，很高兴啊，有很多的人，一起，分享，动物是我们的朋友，也就是说，动物和我们互相依存的道理。
Today, I'm so delighted that there are so many people to discuss with you about animals are our friends and the fact that we're all living interdependently.
我们在座的很多人都可能认为，除了极个别的非常可爱的一些宠物以外，动物并不是我们的朋友。很多人都认为是动物呢，应该是我们该使用的一些事物，或者呢，我们人类需要使用的，它是一种工具。除此之外呢，我一说起动物是我们的朋友的话，很多人的观念当中，也就是说思想当中呢，好像很难以接受。
People tend to think that apart from some very cute kittens or puppies, very cute pets, other animals are not our humans' friends. People tend to regard animals as our food or something to use just for entertainment or something. When I talk about that animals should be our friends,People express the difficulty that they can accept this idea. They question the idea.
但是这种想法，就也就是说，动物不是我们的朋友，动物是我们的事物。这种想法呢，虽然是我们人类的一个，它是一种思想上，固有的一种习惯，也是一种，常见的观念。但从我们生命的平等线上面讲呢，应该可以称为所有的动物跟我们的人类一样，是我们的朋友。这一点呢，我们并不是说是一个理论上的建立，应该说是从很多道理就会明白。我想我们今晚上在座的很多的东西方的这个善良的认识呢，可能要会扪心自问，要想一想到底动物与我们之间有什么样的关系。
But this thought or view is just a habitual tendency for humans. That doesn't mean that it is right.We regard animals as our food or as our tool. That's just a wrong view that is not correct. Actually, in terms of living, in terms of life, sentient beings, humans and animals are all equal. We share the same equality. We're just like friends. And this view, we should not just accept it as a theory, as a hypothesis. We should understand it. we should assimilate it and internalize it. So I hope tonight people who are here are both from the Western world and the Eastern world. You're all very benevolent and kind. So let's all ask ourselves the questions in a heartfelt way. What should be the relationship between animals and human beings?
动物，其实不管是什么样的动物，它都有痛苦的感受，也有快乐的感受。如果我们宰杀它的时候呢，它跟我们人类一模一样的，非常痛苦，而且它希望它的生命继续在这个世界上，而不愿意呢就离开这个世界。同时，我们不管是使用什么样的工具或者说方法来宰杀它，但它的身心分解是极其痛苦的。这一点很多人类可能会没有想到，甚至我们现在的大量的广告或者是一些宣传就隐瞒了动物背后的它的残杀的一些场景或者说实际情况。
Regardless of what animals they may be, they all share the same sufferings and happiness as we human beings. They all feel suffering and happiness. And when they are being slaughtered, they feel extreme anguish. They are in an agonizing suffering. They hope that their life will live on. They don't wish to leave this earth. They don't live to die. They don't wish to die. So, whatever tool we use to slaughter them, to torture them, they experience suffering. And we are not, and most of us are not aware of that. Actually, nowadays, a lot of advertisement and a lot of advertisement through social media sometimes even obscure the fact that animals are being slaughtered and animals are in great suffering.
我们人类到底该不该杀这些动物呢？关于这个问题上面是美国有一个非常著名的劳动联盟的主席啊，叫做是查韦斯先生，他曾经就是具有研究性的就是说过，他说呢就因为他的这个素食主义呢，实际上他为什么是变成一个素食主义呢？因为他看到这些动物呢像我们人类一样，他们有恐惧，他们有寒冷，他们有饥渴，还有他们有不开心等等，就是这样的时候，他会深深地感到，也就是说我们素食主义跟动物王国之间呢有个密切的关系。他有一个效果，通过他的行为呢，他质疑我们人类到底该不该宰杀这些动物，到底该不该食用这些动物。所以我想从他的语言当中，我们今天在座的人呢也应该值得需要深思。
So, let us ask this question, ask us this question again. Should we human beings really have the right to slaughter other sentient beings, to slaughter other animals? In America, a famous labor leader named Jarvis, Cesar Jarvis, once he spoke from an empirical perspective that I became a vegetarian after realizing that animals feel afraid, cold, hungry, and unhappy, just like we do. I feel very deeply about vegetarianism and the animal kingdom. It was my dog Boycott who led me to question the right of humans to eat other sentient beings. So in light of this, we should ask ourselves, do we have the right to slaughter other animals, to eat other animals. So from our words, we should take his words into consideration and really take into great account.
我是从他的语言当中呢，分析出第一段话的意思呢。 就是说，我们人类跟动物呢，应该在感受上是平等的。它有害怕、寒冷、害怕饥渴、害怕不开心等等。我们人类也是这样的，所以，我们的感受应该是平等的。So
let us analyze his words. First, in the first place. There is equality between human beings and animals in terms of feeling afraid, cold, hungry, and unhappy.
从大的第二段话当中呢，我发现，也就是说，我们不吃肉，素食主义者，素食主义呢，实际上是跟动物王国，或者是跟动物界呢，有个密切的联系。 如果我们实际上的人，吃肉的人越来越少的话呢，那么动物世界的快乐呢就是越来越多。And
from his second sentence, I noticed, I observed that, abstaining from meat eating, in other words, vegetarianism, has a close relationship with the animal kingdom. That is to say, the less meat we eat, the more happier, the much happier the animal kingdom will feel.
第三层意思，我想，到底我们人类有没有权利吃动物？虽然我们现在，可以说践踏他们的生命，但实际上，我们人类因为有权利，如果要可以吃别的生命的话呢？ 那我们人类当中，也是有个别的一些身份比较低贱的人呢，是不是也可以用高贵的人，就是称为用高贵的人来就是适用他们？所以在他的最后一个甚是或者说是他的这个考虑呢，我想不仅仅是他一个人的这种思维，我们很多人应该要可能思考。虽然现在我们习惯上地球上的人都。 都认为是我们该吃该杀，应该是该我们吃的。但是这种观念到底合理还是不合理？我希望我今天在这里不明确的判断，但是我们每一个人应该可以思考。你如果有一个充分的理由呢，你就可以放肆的随意的你就适用。
And in his third sentence, we asked, do we humans really have the right, the privilege to eat animals? Although that nowadays animals or we humans seem to have the right, have the privilege to slaughter the animals. Yet, in that sense, we should ask one more question. In us humans, there are inner classifications. There are noble humans, there are noble human beings, and there are those who are from a much lower class. So let us ask this question. Should the human beings from the noble class, from the higher class, slaughter have the right to slaughter the noble the human beings from the lower class? So that is a really question to ask. So today, I'll take this opportunity to discuss with you, to let you think, do we really have the right? Do you really have the right to slaughter other animals? This is not the case where I give a definite conclusion, where I give a definite answer. We should or we shouldn't. No, I would not do that. But I will now leave you an answer, leave you a question, and leave you to think. Do we have the right?
关于这个问题呢，著名的戏剧家 肖波拉，他曾经说过，他说动物是我们的朋友，我不是我们的朋友。所以这句话，我想不仅仅是我的思考，应该是大乘佛教的非常经典的这种意义。更重要的，现在很多著名的人士呢，他们也是思考过。
An Irish playwright, the famous playwright George Bernard Shaw, once said, "Animals are my friends, and I don't eat my friends." So, in light of his words, we can see that this question or this issue is not just the issue that I should think about. This thought of not killing other people, not killing other sentient beings. This is not limited to the Buddhist tradition, the Buddhist doctrine. In the world, there are so many noble beings, there are so many noble and decent human beings. They are all thinking about the question, do we have the right and should we eat the animals?
关于这个问题，如果是按照我们大乘佛教讲呢，当然是不是一个逆论上，事实在在的，动物是跟我们人类一样的，就完全是我们的朋友。这一点是，从他的实际的修行当中、行为当中都讲得很好。比如说，佛教当中有一个叫做《楞严经》，《楞严经》里面说，我们不吃动物的肉。 不穿动物的皮，那么获得解脱的。《楞严经》当中有这样的，如果谁故意去杀生，有些人故意去吃肉，这两个的过患呢是等同的。当然，这个是一个我象征性的引用一个一句而已。实际上，在大乘佛教的关于慈悲心和关于动物的爱护方面的话呢，我想是应该在全世界的文学来讲。 大乘佛教是最非常有说服力的一种，就实实在在的一种这个教义。And
on the subject of not killing other human, not killing other sentient beings, and caring for all the sentient beings, the Mahayana Buddhism has a very pure doctrine both. Theoretically and practically, that animals are our friends. We should treat them equally, just as we treat our human friends. To exemplify, the Shurangama Sutra, in this sutra it says, and Rinpoche gave the quote for that, and it means that people who wear silk, leather boots, furs, or eat meat. Cannot transcend this three world. That means cannot transcend the samsara. Both physically and mentally, one must avoid the bodies and the byproducts of living beings by neither wearing them nor eating them. And also, the sutra goes on to say that intentionally eating animals' meat is as guilty as intentionally killing them. So that is two examples that I give in Mahayana tradition, in Mahayana doctrines. That's just two, but there are a lot. There are a multitude of them in the Mahayana traditions. There are a multitude of them, and the Mahayana Buddhism really embodies the spirit of caring for other beings and treat them with respect and love.
如果我们在座的人有兴趣，可以。 学习一些大乘的论点，像大乘经庄严论，或者说如菩萨行论等等。如果学习这部论点的时候呢，我们进一步认识到，我们人类呢，需要还有一个怎么讲啊，就是七世界的。 外在的这种互相这个依存和依赖，那么更重要的，我们人类呢，跟我们身边的各种各样的动物呢，也是不可缺少的。所以有一种 发自内心的怜悯心，慈悲心呢，就是自然而然会引发的。因此，其实人类呢，就并不是是我们有些人想象的那样，就是是整个地球的主宰，就是他并不是是他来，控制所有的物类。从时间上讲，我想我们在这个地球上呢，就是先就是动物就是成了我们就是第一个主人，然后就是人类这个形成的。所以从很多方面我们去分析的时候呢，我们身边的无论是任何一个动物呢，其实它应该是值得我们去保护的，值得我们去应该去素养的，值得我们去应该关心的。
Well, for some of you who are here, if you are interested in learning Mahayana traditions, in learning Mahayana classics, I suggest that you learn the Mahayana, the ornament of Mahayana sutras, and the Bodhisattva activities, literally. And if you learn these two sastras, if you learn these two scriptures, you will realize that, yes, we human beings rely upon this outside world, that is the world, that is the earth. But most importantly, we rely on other sentient beings. We all share the same planet, and we all share the same feelings. So if you recognize that, on recognizing this, love and compassion from your inner heart will arise instantaneously and most spontaneously. If we think about it, that human beings do not dominate this world. Of course, we can discuss these questions from various perspectives, but from the perspectives of, how long that we human beings have dominated this earth, we can see that we human beings are not the first. The animals came before us. So from this perspective and from all other perspectives, we can see that any animals, regardless of who they are, regardless of what kind they may be, we should pay them attention and care for them and protect them. That is our duty, that is our responsibility.
关键是现在我们很多人就看不到动物是怎么杀的，可能经常看到的是这个很好的一些视频。如果我们的厨房里面你所吃的牛也好，羊也好，还有很多动物，让它的身上一块一块的要切下来的话，很多人都可能不敢吃。
Well, I think that the lack of concern for the lack of concern for other animals, for other sentient beings, the root of that is the modern society obscures the fact that the animals are slaughtered in an anguished way. We most human beings do not see the fact that how animals are slaughtered. In our kitchens, when we open our refrigerator, we can see beef and veal, but we do not see that how cattle and sheep are slaughtered. For if we do, we do not have the courage to eat them and see these bodies.
我以前十六岁我才开始读小学，这个之前我那个在山上放牛放羊，然后整天的是在蓝天白云下，就是跟牛群呢就是一起生活。然后这个时候我就感觉，就是比如说牦牛生病的时候呢，我心里很伤心；它死了的时候呢，就是我心里也是特别伤心。当它开心的时候呢，我也很开心。有时候在山上放牛的时候呢，我看到牦牛在吃草，然后 我觉得我自己肚子饿的时候呢，我也去吃一点，但是呢，我吞不下去，就是然后我想看这个牦牛就是吃的非常好，然后我呢就吞不下去，就是最后呢就是有时候有点尴尬，但不管怎么样呢，每天都是处于一种这样的这个生活当中的话呢，好像是最后确实把这个牛亲呢就是跟自己的这种这个家人一样的，一旦就是。 被别人宰杀了，或者是被这个其他的猎物就是吃掉的话，那就是就流过很多的泪。我想现在很多城市里面的人呢，可能是没有机会，就是看到这些动物的自由自在的这种自然的生活。It
was not until that I'm 16 that I started my primary school. Before the age of 16, I used to, I would herd cattle and sheep in the mountains. And under the blue sky and the white cloud, I just live with them. I just live with them and play with them. When they get sick, then I feel very sad. And when they are happy, then I'm happy. Sometimes when they are hungry and they start eating grass, I feel like that I like to eat grass too. I like, but the grass is not something for me to eat, so I can't not swallow them. So in a situation like this, under such circumstances, I live with the animals just like I live with my families. And once they got slaughtered, I got very sad. And shed so many tears. But unfortunately, now city dwellers, people in the city, do not have the opportunity to see this, to see how natural we live with them, and how sad that they are being slaughtered.
现在很多人认为是动物的肉呢，跟这个蔬菜好像没有什么差别，尤其是现在。 很多的这种农场啊，里面就这个就这种怎么讲，就是那动物特别多。那天我去信息呢，他们说现在整个国家有好像一万三千多个这个养殖场，13000多个这个牛啊，就是这种场啊，每一个场。 就只是有这么多场，每一个场呢，就是有几千几万个，所以说呢，好像，确实我们每天都是有这个人类啊，就这么多的这种宰杀，就是有时候呢，应该说，我们人类的行为是应该很恐怖的，到底恐怖分子是不是每一个人？我在怀疑。
Nowadays, some people tend to think that eating meat is just as usual as eating vegetables, especially when the meat is produced from farms or factories. In farms, there are many animals in them. There are many animals in the farms. When I went to New Zealand, I heard that there are over 13,000 beef farms in there and over 13,000 sheep farms in there. And in each of these farms, thousands of cattle or sheep or a mixture of them were raised in there, waiting to be slaughtered. So I can't help thinking that there are so many slaughtering happening or occurring in this world right now, and I wonder if anyone should be the terrorist, should start a terrorist attack.
有时候我们去一些批发市场或者是一些商店。 百货商场里面买一些食物的地方啊，应该说大多数都是肉食品。 啊，然后我们去不管是东方还是西方哪个国家的任何一个小小的餐厅里面，也有许许多多的一些在下的这个状况。所以从某种意义上看呢，我们每天在这个人类世界上呢，应该是在下动物的数量呢，不可思议，不可计数。无论是你到哪里，就可以看得到血迹，也可以看得到当时他在下过程当中的这些留下来的泪迹，同时也应该听得到他当时的这种痛苦的这个呼唤声。
These days, if you go to some markets, some wholesale markets, and some supermarkets, you can find that the stuff being selling there mostly are meats, beef or veal. And in restaurants, no matter it is in the Eastern world or the Western world, you can find that there are so many dishes that are made of meat. So that is the situation of our slaughtering. So we can calculate from that every day the number of animals being slaughtered is incredibly big, incredibly huge. And everywhere we go, we can see the blood they shed and the tears they shed, and as well as the voices of their suffering. They express suffering, not use words, but use their voice.
我始终认为，其实就掠杀动物的人呢，应该不是好人，是个坏人。这个说法呢，也不仅仅是我。如果我说的话，我人很小，很多杀动物人不高兴。但实际上是他是著名的哲学家叔本华他说的。他说，宰杀动物的人都是坏人，啊，是这句话，就是应该是叔本华，就是著名的哲学家他说的。从他的这种语言当中呢，我们也看出，实际上为了就是人们的就是短暂的一种食欲，短暂的一顿饭，我们会断了多少人的非常多少众生的非常珍贵的。那非常非常执着的就是这么一个生命，就所以我们其实吃肉呢，从某种意义上就是吃其他众生的生命。
I always hold the belief that people who kill animals is bad people, are bad people, and I'm not the only one who thinks that. The great philosopher Arthur Schopenhauer once said, it may be confidently asserted that he who is cruel to animals cannot be a good man. So in light of his words, we can infer that just for the sake of a human's temporary desire for dishes, for delicious dishes, we take the precious life of other sentient beings, which they attach most importance to, and which they are most love. So from that, we can infer that eating meat is as guilty as killing animals.
其实这个杀害众生的一些整个过程的话呢，如果亲眼看到了以后呢，肉都不想吃。大概是应该七八年前吧，就是有一次我去青海去放生，然后放生的过程当中，我们看到了很多的一些动物的那个宰杀场啊，就本来是就不让进的，但是呢，我们就去拍了一些，后来呢，他们把它做成一个纪录片呢、啊。 听说很多人吃了看了一盒呢都不想吃肉，就是叫这个慈悲之旅还是什么，我忘了名字。其实当时我们去看到的四合呢，很多在沙场，就是包括有些牦牛，就是就活活的把这个头呢，就是用刀就是砍断，非常残忍。就看到之后的话呢，很长时间就是一直这种恐怖的这个场面呢，就是浮现在眼前。就是不要说吃肉，就是连其他食物都就是很难想吞下去的。晚上睡觉的时候也是经常。在闭着眼睛也是，就是出现就是当时的这个杀害的，就是这种这个场面，就相当于是我们是在战争时代的一种这个恐惧的这种这个战场一样。就是有时候人类可能换一个角度来看内幕的时候呢，会触目惊心的。
Well, I guess that we people would not eat meat, would abstain from meat eating, when we actually see the process of their being slaughtered in person. Several years ago, when I was engaging in an activity of releasing captured lives, I was doing it was in Qinghai province, and we went to several slaughtering house, and it was recorded into a documentary. At first, the slaughtering house didn't allow us to enter. But anyhow, we entered it and recorded the process of the animals being slaughtered, and we posted the documentary. And a lot of people, once they have seen this documentary, they don't want to eat meat at all and anymore. And this documentary's name is called The Journey to Compassion and Love. I don't know if that is correct. I just remember it literally. Rinpoche said he does not know that if the name of this documentary is correct or not. And in this documentary, the head of the cattle, the head of the yaks, were just cut off using knives very brusquely. And upon seeing that, we don't want to eat food at all, let alone eating meat. And at night when we go to sleep, we remember that scene vividly. When we close our eyes and the scene just appears in our memory, it just felt so frightening. So I think it'll be much useful to help us understand the suffering of the animals if we look deeper into that which has been obscured from our sight.
对动物的这种宰杀的关心呢，我不是短短的时间当中，应该很多年以来一直很关心。十五年前我写过一本书，叫做是悲惨世界。悲惨世界里面就是讲了很多宰杀动物的一些状况。我也当时采访了很多的中国的很多人，也引用了一些其他地方的一些人。那么其实这个杀害动物的手段的是各种各样的，但是都非常非常残忍。所以我当时想就是取名为悲惨世界，因为这个世界当中吃动物的人太多了，动物的这个生命付出的太多了。但后来就一看，就是原来这个《悲惨世界》的书的名字呢，就是是很早以前就是遇过的一本书的名字，但我不是看它的，回来才发现它的。不管怎么样，后来出版的过程当中呢，有些人说不能悲惨世界，我们现在世界是美好的、幸福的。你如果要出版的话，那要叫善待生命，不能说悲惨世界。 不管怎么样，荷兰还是有很多国家的这种文字来这个翻译过的。在这里面呢，我就讲了，动物应该是我们的朋友，但是呢，我们为什么是就是肆无忌惮的，就是会摧毁他们的生命？其实他们的生命呢，像一朵梅花一样的，非常非常的美丽。如果让它展现，让它自己成长的话呢，就是多么的这种灿烂。可是呢，我们人类就并没有想到它的价值。
The attention that I paid to the animals that are being slaughtered has been lasting for so many years. 15 years ago, I wrote a book in which I describe the circumstances or the process of animals being slaughtered. And I named the book The World of Misery. I interviewed a lot of people, and they told me about many tools and many methods they take to kill the animals. But I feel that no matter what methods they take, they're just cruel. They're just causing so much anguish. There's an agonizing way. So I decided to name the book The World of Misery. Later I find that this name just resembles the famous writer Hugo's book, the name of the book, the Hugo's book. So I took this transcript to a publisher, and the publisher suggested me not to name the book The World of Misery, because that may seem too pessimistic. Instead, they told me to name the book Treat Sentient Beings Kindly and Benevolently. Anyhow, I named the book The World of Misery, and now this book has been translated into so many languages, many languages. So I have to ask, animals are our friends, and their life is just like a beautiful flower. If we allow them to blossom, they will do it most beautifully. So why slaughtering them? I have to ask, why slaughtering them?
你是哪里的？
Where are you from?
Oh.
Yeah.
Yes, in Central America.
美国中部的一个 a state, a city?
No, it's a country. It's a very small country in the center of America.
美国中部的一个很小的国一个很小的城镇，很小的城镇。
美国中部的很小的一个国家。看得出来啊，啊，忘了刚才说什么。
You do seem that you come from the Central America.
这样的，刚才我们就讲到了，就是众生，这种被杀的场面呢，是非常残忍。关于这些问题呢，可能。现在的尤其是在工业革命之后，或者说是现在的这个科学革命之后的话，很多人不一定非常清楚。我们每次得到的这些事物呢，都是外面就包装得很好，宣传得非常到位，然后在上面就是配着各种各样的美味。就这样之后呢，我们可能很难想象，就是它的背后呢，就是原来就是付出过这样的代价。
So just now we have talked about how brutal the scene of the animals being killed is. So on the subject of the killing animals and the lack of concern of people that people feel about killing animals, the slaughtering of animals, the root of this lies behind the fact of massive production. After the revolution of industrialization, our products are packaged in a very beautiful way, in a very accomplished way. So we cannot imagine that which has been obscured from the beautiful package, that which has been made unseen from the beautiful package.
如果我们翻过来说，把动物都真正是当作自己的朋友那样的话呢，实际上很多动物对我们带来的快乐也跟人类一样的。现在很多西方国家和包括东方国家的人呢，就爱养一些宠物啊，就把自己的跟家人一样的，就非常爱他们。而他们的行为当中呢，也对自己带来这个幸福啊，就是这种安全感呐、啊，还有一种平时的这种生活呢，就是没有这种孤独啊等等，就是有许许多多的一些利益。
And in contrast, if we treat our animal friends with love and respect and benevolence, we treat them as friends, and they will bring us much happiness, just like our human friends do. In the Western world, people love to raise pets, people love to have pets, because once we raise a pet, it will bring us happiness, sense of security, and our loneliness just goes away.
可能你们在座的人很多人都可能看过，以前我也看过有一本书啊，其实在这里描述了一个叫波温的一个流浪汉，就是从小都是被父母遗弃的，后来呢没有工作，没有家庭，没有爱情，没有生活，然后呢他就开始上这个毒瘾，就开始吸毒，最后已经被社会已经遗弃，就非常痛苦，就是精神就是马上要崩溃。到这个时候呢，就是他在街头已经遇到了就是身体受伤的一个猫。
And these days I've had the opportunity to read a book about a street cat.And a hobo, or a person who go busting in the street. The cat is called Bob, and the man is called Bovin. Perhaps you have read this book and you have heard about both of them. Bovin is a man, ever since his childhood, his parents got divorced.And somehow he seems just discarded by his family. So nowadays, so when he grew up, he did not have any families, he did not have any job, and he did not find the love of his life, and most importantly, he did not have a livelihood, he does not have a livelihood. And what is worse, he began to sniff glue. So we can regard him then as a person who is deserted by the society, who is forgotten by the society. But one day on the street, he came across a cat. He came across a cat which is also has a wound.has an infected wound on his leg, on the cat's leg.
他遇到这只猫的时候呢，就 这个这只猫的这个身体呢已经受伤了。其实人的心灵已经受伤了，动物的身体已经受伤了，两个商人呢互相帮助，但后来呢这个人的心灵呢也恢复了，他可以过正常的生活，而动物的身体呢也已经恢复了。后来在世界上已经非常著名的一个人，猫也很出名的，后来就是获得了很多世界的动物奖。所以我想在梦中意义上看呢，我们每一个人的身边呢就是都可以找到一只猫，就都可以找到很多的这种可爱的这个动物。其实每一个动物呢，我经常在想，只不过是它是稍微它的本能就是比较愚笨而已，就除此之外的话呢，就是它跟我们人类的很多的这种灵感，就是我们人类的很多的觉受都应该是相通的。关于这个问题方面的话，我们世界上的大多数的人呢从来没有想过，就是这是也是我们人类当中的怎么讲啊，就不敢说愚痴，但是呢也是我们的不足之处。
Now, Bob and Balvin, they saved each other's physical health and mental health respectively. The cat is in a physical wound, and Balvin, the man, was in a mental wound, was going through a mental suffering. And they helped each other, and in the end, they killed each other, they cured each other. So now,Balvin has become a famous person, a person who enjoyed much fame and has won so many prizes concerning caring for animals. So I like to think that animals may not be as intelligent as us human beings, but they share perceptions. They have perceptions and they have feelings, and that's what they have.And also, that's what we human beings mostly ignore. So that's something that we're ignorant of. That's something we have to take into serious consideration. I'm not saying that people who do not realize the fact that animals have perceptions and have feelings, these people are foolish, these people are stupid. I'm just saying that you need to just think more. You need just to take it into consideration. Animals that do have perceptions and feelings.
总而言之呢，很希望，每一个人，内心当中有一种爱心。这种爱心呢，不仅仅是，这是我们的人类，应该，它可以就涉及到，它可以便于，所有的，就是这个生命。因为人有了爱的时候呢，就是这个世界应该可以说是很美好的。
So I hope that there should be cultivated a kind of tenderness, a kind of loving and kindness in every person's inner heart.And this benevolence, this loving compassion should not be limited to human beings. It should extend to all the sentient beings in the world. Why? Because if we have love, if we have cultivated love and compassion in our heart, then our world will become much better and more beautiful.
今天听到我的聊天我后面呢跟大家要布置一两个作业。凡是今天听我的课的人呢，如果尊重我、尊重生命的话呢，希望你，2015年的这一年当中呢，要 至少也是救一个生命，就是放一只生以上，就是这是第一个作业。第二个作业呢，2015年的这一年当中呢，你要吃一天的素啊，至少也是吃一天的素，这是第二个作业。第三个作业是我们今天刚好是月事，我们在拉荣干，就是在佛学院是就正好是这个月事啊，就这个特殊的一个日子，所以呢我们学院的出家人都在恭修观音法门，我希望呢我们每一个人明天之前吧，24小时之内念108遍南无观世音菩萨，或者说嗡嘛呢叭咪吽，三个作业，放生一只，一个以上，当然多的话千倍万十万百万都可以，然后吃素一天，多的话呢就360天，更多的也可以，然后念观音心咒108遍，多的话呢10008遍、1008遍都可以，这是我今天就利用这个时间跟大家分享的过程当中呢，也是这么一个小小的要求，特别希望呢我们每一个人应该善待生命，就像自己的生命一样，观察周围的很多众生的生命也是那么的可贵，也是那么的重要，更重要我们要尊重每一个生命，这就是我向我们人类最高的权益。谢谢。
So I'd like to assign a few homeworks for people who are here who have heard my talk. If you respect me and if you respect life, then please do these three homeworks. First, in the year 2015, in this year, you should save at least one sentient beings from slaughtering. You should release at least one creature from being slaughtered. So that is the first assignment. Of course, that please notice at least you can release or save lives as many as you want, as most as the limitless number. And the second, you have to abstain from meat eating at least for one day in the year 2015, in this year. Or you can stop eating meat, you can abstain from meat eating for at most as 365 days in the year 2015, that is up to you, but at least one day. And thirdly, today is an auspicious day, and this moment is also precious because a lunar eclipse is occurring right now. And monks and nuns, and as well as lay practitioners in our academy, are reciting the mantra of Arashtakvara while we're having this lecture. So I'm going to ask you to recite the mantra of Avalokiteshvara Om Mani Padme Hum for at least 108 times to finish this 108 times before in 24 hours before next day, by the next day. So these are the three homeworks. Of course, you can recite as many mantras as you like, but that's my least requirement. If you respect me, if you respect life, please do it. And so to conclude this speech, I'd like to ask for all of you who are here and all of you who listen to my talk, please respect life and treat life with respect and love. And please let us have the acknowledgement that life is precious for all and life is important to all, no matter you are human beings or no human beings. So please have this acknowledgement, and this should be our human. This should be the highest goal, the most lofty goal of our human beings. Thank you. Okay, the lecture has concluded, has come to an end. So thank you for your time. I hope Rinpoche's thought-provoking talk may light up your life a little bit more, just like Zhang Dong wrote in his famous poem, "No man is an island entire of itself. Each is a piece of continent, a part of the main." We tend to think dangers and disasters to be horrific epidemics, terrorist attacks, and wars, violence, starvation. But we fail to recognize the root cause for all of that, which is the lack of acknowledgement that we are a community. We are on the same planet, and we share the same sunrise and sunset. No one has granted anyone any right to eat other living beings. So hope some of you would lessen your intake of meat out of a kind and compassionate heart. You may not want to be a vegetarian, but even one vegetarian day a month or a year would help our animal friends a lot.
我们今天的开始马上就要接近尾声了，感谢您的聆听，希望仁波切今天的开始能给您的生活带来一点启示。就像约翰·多恩在其著名的诗作中所说的那样，没有一个人是自成一体与世隔绝的孤岛，每一个人都是广袤大陆的一部分。我们通常认为各种危险灾害 来自于可怕的瘟疫、恐怖袭击、战争、暴力或饥荒，但我们不知道这一切的根源在于我们不了知，我们是一体的。不了知我们生活在同一个星球上，共享日出和日落。没有人可以给任何人权利去吞食其他的生命。希望在座中可以有人因为怜悯动物而减少吃肉。 可能你不会变成一位素食者，但是即便一个月中只有一天吃肉，也可以帮助到我们的动物朋友们。一天吃肉？吃肉啊，吃素了。哪怕我们只有一天吃素的，最好是只有一天吃肉，那这样方的更多了。OK。
Well, thank you for your time. Next, we'll have a Dharma talk in Tibetan without any translation. So if you are interested in the topic, the beauty of Tibetan culture, and you have a mastery in the Tibetan language, you may join us. Please join us. We'll also have the transmission of 8 verses of Training the Mind by Lauren Tompa. Now let's dedicate the merit that we've collected today by chanting the essence of the ocean of the aspiration.
再次感谢您的聆听，我们将有藏语开示，届时将没有任何翻译。如果您对于藏文化的魅力感兴趣，可以继续聆听。今天还会有朗日唐巴尊者的修心八颂的传承。现在我们一起念诵愿海精髓，将今天的善根回向给所有的朋友们。